Hi, my name's Jeff Jones, director of the Big Blue Band in Mesquite, Texas. A while back, I had a completely original, somewhat borrowed idea to pick up band directors and drive them around in my wife's 2011 Honda Odyssey minivan and have a conversation. This is Maestros and Minivans. My guest today is Mr. Richard Floyd, Director Emeritus of the UIL Music Office. Mr. Floyd has served as a band director in the state of Texas for over 50 years and has spent the last 25 years as the director of the Austin Symphonic Band.
It was a nice lunch. I enjoyed that very much.
It's a good place. Yeah. But anyway, you know, just to wrap it all up, this Maestros and Minivans thing that Jeff Jones has got going, I mean, it's going to be terrible. I'm glad we're in agreement that you don't want to have any part of
it. Well, first time I heard about it, I rolled my eyes back. I chuckled a little bit and said, that isn't happening.
That's what I told him.
Yeah, well, and even if it did, there's no way in the world you're going to get me in a car with that guy.
I think I said the exact same thing. Yeah. So, wow.
Well, great minds think alike. So
there you go.
What can we say?
There you go. What can I say? You know. Yeah. Well, hey, do you need a ride?
I'm just gonna get Uber. Yeah. I'm in good shape. Yeah.
All right. Hey, well, it's really nice having lunch with you again.
It was my joy. You take care.
All right.
This totally is not happening.
It's Richard Floyd, everybody.
Oh, my God.
Floyd, you're not going to tell Dr. Henry that I do Uber pickups at lunch.
No, as long as you behave yourself.
Okay, good. Let's go for a ride. There was something I've been meaning to talk to you about.
We can work a deal on that. Okay.
Well, I'm so glad you agreed to come and be on Maestros and Minivans with us today.
Well, it was kind of a surprise agreement, if you analyze it, but we're here.
Yeah, I mean, so when Bethany told me I should start doing the Uber stuff at lunch, I had no idea, you know, where it would take me. So that's really been great. Now, family of musicians, were your parents musicians?
Absolutely not. My mom sung in the church choir. She had a very nice voice. Dad was pretty much, he was pretty much about as close to being tone deaf as somebody could. And my grandfather lost his hearing in his 40s. So he was almost totally deaf. My dad had to wear hearing aid. But luckily, whatever fate that was has passed me by. I'm sure there's some people that say that I can't hear, but that's a different kind of not hearing. So.
And you grew up in the Richardson School District,
I grew up in Richardson, that's right. Mm-hmm. And at that time, the band director actually was a graduate of Hardin-Simmons, had been in the cowboy band. So guess what kind of uniforms that we wore back then? They were gray uniforms with purple and gold trim and a cowboy hat.
Clarinet player, yes.
Clarinet player. Actually, I wanted to play saxophone, but you know, the world hasn't changed that much. There were too many saxophone players, and so my band director convinced me to play clarinet. And he said, when I grew up, I could play saxophone if I wanted to. So I was in the fifth grade and started playing clarinet. And in the seventh grade was in the high school band. Middle school was a non-existent concept at that time. You were either in the band or you weren't in the band.
At clarinet all through high school?
Clarinet all the way through high school. I started playing saxophone. Obviously got interested in a little jazz combo that some friends we had together. And the way I got my first saxophone, I lived out in the country and I was in a 4-H club. And my project every spring was to raise chickens.
Okay.
And at that time there was this competition called the Chicken of Tomorrow contest. And it was literally the precursor of the big poultry farms that they have now. It was how big can we get a chicken in the shortest period of time? So they brought me 100 chickens, and I had them for 9 weeks. And the goal was to see how much you could fatten them up. And then the county agent came and picked the best 15 and took them to the competition. And lo and behold, got a phone call that mine were in the top 12. And I got there and we were selected the fourth biggest chickens in the state, and they auctioned them off. and I had, I believe it was $300 is what I got. And I went out and bought me a tenor saxophone with the $300 I got from the chicken competitions. As it turned out, my brother wanted to play clarinet also. And our family, we were blessed in countless ways, but one of them was not abundant financial resources, to the point that when it was time for him to start, the family decided, mom and dad decided, that there was not enough money to buy another clarinet, so they bought another mouthpiece. So there was a period of time that Bobby and I shared the same clarinet. So there would be a concert, and the beginning band was going to play, and he would have the clarinet, and I would be sitting with the high school band with my mouthpiece. And when the middle school got through with their demonstration concert, then we would connect up, and I would get the clarinet. He would take his mouthpiece off. I'd put my mouthpiece on, and I would go sit down and play with the high school band.
I mean, it's no Audi, but I'm telling you, the turning radius, not bad. And you can seriously pick up some speed. I mean, how fast do you think we're going right now?
Faster than I think we should be going by a school, actually.
No, it's fine. The little light's not flashing, no big deal.
Well, okay, all right.
But I mean, you know, 65, it feels like 35.
Yeah.
Are you?
I'm impressed. I've never been in a minivan before, honestly. I thought they were for old people.
We may actually just stop.
Whoops.
Here for, I'm just going to, so... If you don't mind, let me do the talking.
This is yet another reason that I was hesitant about being a part of this whole enterprise.
Yes. Hey, officer, how are you?
Got the driver's license on you?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Was there a problem?
I'll explain that to you here in a second.
Yes, sir. And I wouldn't ever do this, but I just, if there's any chance... The gentleman in the car here is kind of a big deal, and this is really embarrassing. So if there's any way that I could avoid, you know, the ticket at all, that would just really be...
It wouldn't matter if you had H. Robert Reynolds in the car. You got to slow it down. Doesn't matter who you have in the car.
Yes, sir.
I can't give you any kind of special treatment.
Yes, sir. I understand that completely, sir. I'm sorry for even asking. I wouldn't. Yeah.
If you want to hold up here, I'll be right back, and let me check your license stuff out.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I'm very sorry about this. I had no
idea. It just, things like this just shouldn't happen.
Yes, sir. You said you had to SMU?
I went to SMU. I looked at a number of schools, but my clarinet teacher, the last 2 years I was in high school, was a gentleman named Oakley Pittman, and he was the band director and the clarinet professor at SMU. And it just seemed to be a natural sequence.
How many years were you in Richardson ISD? And where did you go from there?
Well, I was at Richardson Junior High School for 5 years.
Okay.
And then the town was growing like crazy. And they decided that they were going to be opening a new high school. And it was actually named after J.J. Pierce, who was the superintendent of schools for so many years. And we started it out with they just took the 7th and 8th grade, added a 9th grade, next year added a 10th grade.
Okay.
So it took several years for it to evolve into a full high school.
Now, were you the band director at J.J. Pierce High School, or was there a team of you guys there, or was it just...
Actually, we did have two directors there.
Okay.
But by that time, we were also teaching, starting the beginners in the 6th grade. So you had usually multiple school assignments. You had a couple of elementary schools that you would deal with, and then didn't go to the high school or go to the middle school, depending on the case. It was an interesting growth process, and for whatever it's worth, it's the big bad old UIL of that day said that there was no such thing as non-varsity.
Okay.
The number of A's that you had beside your school said that's where you go. So we were competing in the second highest tier of competition then, with no seniors at all. And in fact, the year before, I mean, when we didn't have any juniors, we were a varsity school. we just had to struggle early on to find pieces of music that would be playable, that we could do. And but we had great kids, and they were very dedicated, and the program really really took off quickly. And the last 2 years I was at Pierce High School, I also served as the fine arts director. I wore two hats for a couple of years there, right at the end.
Okay, and then from there?
From there, near the end of my tenure at in the Richardson School District, I started thinking about other things that I might want to do. Like that Peggy Lee song, "Is That All There Is?" I mean, I loved it, and I could have continued to do it, but I felt like there was another button that I needed to push someplace. And I was thinking about going back to graduate school, and they had an interesting thing in Richardson then. You could get if you had not used your sick leave, you could get a sabbatical for a year at half pay to go to graduate school. And I was pretty much interested in doing that. Then I had friends said, well, you know, if you're thinking about wanting to go and teach in a college someplace, well, why don't you go ahead and get your vita put together and start, you know, just it never hurts to submit your material. So I did that, and first couple of places I submitted to, I didn't even get a phone call back, which didn't surprise me. I was just trying to get used to that culture. And then Baylor University had an opening that was coming up. Gene Smith was leaving there. We're a Baptist family, and so I thought, well, that would be an interesting thing to explore. And so, lo and behold, I submitted my material for Baylor, and about 8 weeks later, I got a phone call that they wanted to offer me the position. So, and it was kind of like the proverbial dog that chases a fire truck, and one day they catch one and they have no idea what they're going to do with it. I was in a completely different world overnight. It was a very challenging time in terms of growth. Harvey Pinnock, who was the great golf teacher who wrote the Little Red Book, says, if you want to become a better golfer, you don't have lunch with lousy players. And boy, is he right. Find times to be around inspiring, smart people. The benefits are beyond the belief. So, and I can remember sitting down to have a meal with some of those kinds of people and thinking, oh my gosh, what if they ask me a question and I don't know an answer? Or what if they find out I'm a fraud, that I don't belong here? And some of that was painful, but I loved so much what I was doing, and I did not in any way want to let anybody down in terms of the students or the program or the university. I just committed myself to total focus on the things that I wanted to learn, and then to communicate those things.
So, what's the nicest car you've ever owned?
Probably my favorite car I've ever owned is my Audi TT that I have now. I've always been a sports car person. I'll end up, back before they were Nissans, they were Datsuns. Datsun 280Z, I had one of those. I had a Toyota Supra. The Acura for a while made a small, it was the Integra Sport, that had that turbo engine in it, and that was a great car.
Now, how does the twin turbo compare to a Honda Odyssey? I mean,
we're not talking the same kind of transportation, Jeff. But I just love the feel and handling of small car.
This one is amazing turning radius. Excellent.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Well, probably for its length, I'm sure it does.
Thank you. You ever have folks ride around in your trunk?
I've never had anybody ride around in my trunk.
No.
I rode around in the trunk of my Supra one time.
On purpose?
On purpose.
Was this at the hand of your brother?
No.
It was not? Okay.
No. It had some kind of a rattle in the back of it, and I couldn't figure out what it was. So I had Cheryl driving it, and I got in the back so I could try to hear where it was coming from. Never did find it. It finally, I don't know whether something fell off or it just healed itself, but it finally went away.
Need some GoPro cameras for that.
Yeah.
So tell me about your first car. Did you start driving cars or did you start driving tractors?
Actually, a little tractor first. My dad was a real, our dad was a real craftsman. He could build anything. And he had a, he built us a little toy tractor that had a 1.5 horsepower gasoline motor on it that we would ride all over the yard. And, but no, then I started driving a car. I had a 1950 Chevrolet. It was green. I don't remember. And it was the three-speed gear shift on the steering wheel.
Okay. Now, how did that rate against the Honda Odyssey minivan?
Well, that car had a AM radio, a little trunk, no air conditioning, and a real loud engine. So I would say probably cars have come a long way since that time.
Oh, speaking of, I think we have another call. Would you like to take another?
Sure, let's do it. Right. Let's do it. Let's see what this person has to.
All right, you're on the air.
Oh man. Hey, Jeff.
Turn your radio down. Turn your radio all the way down. Turn it down.
You know, I hate to do this and burst your bubble on this thing, but hey man, I just had lunch a while ago with Mr. Floyd. You know, he told me, I mean, we talked about it for a while, and, you know, we both kind of agreed, you know, it's probably just not a good idea to do this for the sake of your career. You know, kind of like we talked about, you know, it's probably just...
Are you still there? We're not getting you. Are you there?
I'm here.
Are you there? Because, you know, sometimes cell service on this side of town is not...
It's not too good.
It's not the best.
Position at University of Texas with UIL opened, and that was a chance to come back to our state.
Explain how that kind of came together.
I say, looking back with a great deal of pride, I think that people would, when I said I was going to take the position and I would go to TBA that summer, and somebody says, "What in the world did you take that job for?" And my response always was, "I didn't take it for what it was. I took it for what I thought it could be." The vision that I had for the positive role that it could play in terms of repertoire, in terms of priorities. And one of my goals from the very beginning was I wanted to create a very, very high level of ownership in UIL. I didn't want people to think, well, they would wake up one morning and there'd be a mayonnaise jar on their front porch that had the new rules in it, but that there would be lots of input and a lot of dialogue so that everybody would feel like it was their UIL that was making the decision, not some bureaucrat in Austin telling them what to do.
Well, that's hard with such a large group. How did you do that?
People like to feel that their opinion matters. They may not get their way, but at least they know that somebody listened to them and was receptive to the fact that, hey, I have something to say.
For somebody who talks so much and so passionately about music making, how did you deal with that transition to a job that was very administrative?
Well, I was still very much involved in the real world of music. I wasn't sitting behind a desk every day, you know, and the new scores were still coming to me, and I was still on the committees doing the commissioning, and I was still being asked to come and work with the conducting workshop. And those things actually all of a sudden just, I mean, they exploded. Then in addition to that, I was walking out of the Hyatt Hotel one night, I had been to a meeting, and I heard a lady say, "Mr. Floyd." And I looked around to see who it was. She says, "You don't remember me." She says, "I was a saxophone player, and I came to the Summer Wind Ensemble camp at Baylor 2 years in a row. What are you doing now?" And I said, "Well, I live here in Austin, Texas, and I'm with the university and with UIL." She says, "Well, I play in the Austin Symphonic Band, and we're losing our conductor. And I'm wondering, would you be okay with me suggesting that they consider you possibly for that position?" So that was 30 years ago. And
that group, wonderful, wonderful group of human beings. It was a struggling group at first. Then somebody, we went and played something at TBA, and somebody says, you need to take that to Mid, that group needs to go to Midwest. So, and at that time, we were in such bad shape, budgetary-wise, we didn't have any money whatsoever. And they had promised me a small stipend to do it, and finally I said, look, quit worrying about it. We don't have the money. You know, you're not going to pass the hat just to compensate me. So, I mean, it was just fledgling. And then, lo and behold, we sent in the application, and we were accepted. And so the board sat around a table and said, okay, we're going to go. We were totally broke, had no idea how we were going to get there. And we ended up making that trip, and by the time we got through, we had funded the trip. And because of some other good things that had happened, we ended up with about $10,000 in the bank after that. And then the group kind of just took off from there.
What is it that you see as you get out of the community and get to meet folks that are working in the public school systems and all sorts of places, not just here in Texas, but around the United States? What do you see what's your big vision for them, or what is it you try to bring to those programs that maybe in the day-to-day that we get blinders to or miss?
I find that absolutely there is a universal passion for making music well. I can be here in Texas around students that are incredibly, incredibly talented and beautifully taught. We lead the charge. We're at the peak of the mountain in terms of the teaching performance. And those kids, wherever they are, they're willing to let you take them to the next level. I can go to other parts of the country. The teachers absolutely love what they're doing. The kids love what they're doing. They don't have the same depth of experience. They don't know as many fingerings. Maybe the chins aren't as flat. Maybe the equipment is not quite as good. But I have never encountered a situation where students didn't say, take me to the next level. Help me be better. And so I think the main thing we have to do is to take that passion and channel it in such a way that it does two things. It elevates those people in terms of what they're doing, and it also creates a sense of ownership that they want to continue to be a part of that. You're sitting in your chair right now. I'm sitting here right now, not because one day we finally got to play the chromatic scale at 144, or that you finally played a high C on the trumpet. You're sitting here, I'm sitting here because of the way music made you feel. And the feeling in music is the art of the music. It's not the getting it right.
Absolutely.
It's making it special.
So tell us some of the special moments. You have a story that I've heard you tell more than one occasion.
I think the one that you're referring to, the story was shared with me by the great composer Warren Benson. And Warren was at Baylor for a residency. And we were preparing for a concert, and I had said something to the students about kind of where we were, and everybody can always wish you had more time and so forth, and but that all we could do would be trying to be the best that we could be where we were right then. And Warren says, I want to talk about that. So he tells a story about the NBC Symphony in New York. This was in Toscanini. Was doing that orchestra, and that was one of the main infusions of music into the entire country. People would sit around their old-fashioned radios and listen to the NBC Symphony under Toscanini. And those were all, you know, very, very high-skilled, but somewhat very jaded professional musicians. But Warren said that the orchestra came in to begin a concert. It was just going to be another concert. And he said that that Toscanini came in and they were doing a symphony. And he said they started the first movement. And he said it just really had kind of a nice zing to it. There was it just sparkled. And that he said they finished the first movement and began the second movement. The second movement had a lot of quiet solos. And he said that the oboe player played, and all of a sudden the flute player just raised the level a little bit higher. And then he said you could just feel the energy level start to rise. He said the third movement was a scherzo, and he said it just sizzled from beginning to end. And for some reason, they were off the air for a minute before they did the final movement. Toscanini's up there, the orchestra's sitting there just kind of waiting to get started, and the clock is ticking down. And just before they go on, one of the wind players said in a whisper, but loud enough so everybody could hear it, said, go for it. And he said it was the most exhilarating 10 minutes of music that he ever experienced in his life. And he went on to say that the most important thing that came out of that for him, and which became an absolute belief for me, was that you can't predict peak emotional experiences. You can't say that a certain day at a certain time all the stars are going to align and it's going to be wonderful. Or my high school band is going to go to the festival on the coast and at 2 p.m. on Friday it will be the best they've ever played. You can't do that. But the one thing you can do is always go for it. And if you do that every day, those magic moments take care of themselves. And that magic moment may be in the middle of a rehearsal. It may be with a beginner that you see the lights come on, that they've got it. Or it could be at a major performance someplace. I just call it the go for it factor. I even have a necklace that I wear that has that inscribed on it, that I designed myself. And then my wife Cheryl has one. And the one around my neck is only, there's only been two times it hadn't been on my neck. And one time was when I had bypass surgery. I started to ask the surgeon if he would please wear it while we were doing the surgery. And then the other time is our son, Weston, asked if he could wear it for his piano recitals. And then on his 19th birthday, he asked for one. So now he has one, too.
You've played a lot of literature.
I hope so.
And there's hopefully lots more to come.
That's my plan.
How much emphasis do you put on repertoire selection?
It is the most important, absolutely most important decision, the most important element of what we do, is not only as conductors, but as educators. And I think it's incredibly important that we make sure that the music we're performing has the most opportunity for expressiveness and deep music making in it. And we're lucky these days, we have some music all the way down to grade one that has musical content. And I try to think many times, particularly if I'm looking for a grade two piece, I want it to be a grade two piece that I could give to a university wind ensemble and they would get satisfaction from playing it. And I think too that it's important for us to pick pieces that have multiple layers of depth. And I think that we as conductors, and if I had something I would challenge all conductors to consider, is make sure you don't just play music that fits your band or makes your band sound good. You pick music that challenges you artistically and pieces that have musical depth so that you are constantly growing as a musician as you're guiding them to become better musicians. I think that one of the greatest joys beyond all the things we're talking about, one of the great rich blessings that we have in the profession that you and I share is the fact that we are all very good about sharing. We all like to help each other. We can be competitive when the time comes, but it's one big group of kindred spirits.
And it's certainly been an honor to share with you, and thank you for taking the time to come and share with us today. It's
my pleasure.
It's just been an honor to have you here.
My pleasure.
Can't wait to have you back.
Okay, we'll do it.
Thank you, sir.
You bet.